Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The final item of business is a Members' Business debate on Motion 1861 in the name of Alex Gough-Hamilton on long COVID as a condition of concern. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Alex Gough-Hamilton to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Gough-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to rise to speak to the motion in my name. I am dismayed, however, that we are now 18, 19 months into this pandemic, 12 months at least, since the first sufferers of the condition we now know of long COVID had that condition identified. It is, I think, disappointing that it takes opposition time in a members' debate to be to the first lead in this important subject in this chamber. I know it will not be the last, because this will occupy our attention, rightly so, for many years to come. Because, Deputy Presiding Officer, long COVID is accelerating. In October alone, 13,000 new patients were identified with this terrible and debilitating condition. Everybody in this chamber, everyone in our communities knows somebody who has had COVID and is still suffering from it many, many months later. And the effects can be brutal. In fact, it has been described as potentially the largest mass disabling event since the First World War. It is not being overly dramatic to say, Presiding Officer, so poor has been the government's response to long COVID in this country that sufferers in my constituency, in your constituency, would be better off moving to England, given the care pathway that is available to sufferers of long COVID south of the border. That is why my motion calls on the government to act in a meaningful way beyond the long COVID service and the small amounts of money already dedicated to the condition here, by bringing in long COVID clinics in every single health board in this country, by delineating a care pathway for sufferers to follow from the moment they are identified into a range of interventions, whether that's aquatherapy and other forms of physio or other forms of support, but also the inclusion of dedicated nurses. I put this in the motion, Deputy Presiding Officer, because I did a lot of work before COVID with ME sufferers, and I was horrified to learn that there was only one peripatetic ME nurse in the whole of the Eastern Seaboard in Scotland. Many of these sufferers are too ill to leave their homes for long periods of time, and it is incumbent on us to make sure the resources are there to offer them care in their homes. Because people, I'll take an intervention.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Alex Gough-Hamilton, to give way. Does he agree with me that even though the very nature of long COVID is a increasing field of various symptoms and sufferings that individual had, if we had a pathway in Scotland, we could start to collate the evidence which would shorten the long-term need in respect of the services these our constituents need?
Alex Gough-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for the intervention. And Martin Whitfield is absolutely right. And we are, Presiding Officer, behind the curve in how we respond to this. It is a basket of conditions. I'll come on to that in a second. I mean, because people who suffer from long COVID experience a vast range of hundreds of symptoms, not altogether, some very differently, but they are include and not limited to breathing difficulties to the point of asphyxiation, chest pain, numbness, fatigue, tachycardia, diarrhea, neurological conditions, and often in a relapsing and remitting pattern. And the impacts upon activities and daily living and the ability to work are huge. So Martin Whitfield is absolutely right. But aside from physical side effects, long-term COVID sufferers are faced with issues ranging from trauma and to serious discrimination, which I'll come on to again shortly. They report major difficulties in accessing primary or secondary care, and health practitioners who, despite being sympathetic, are unsure or unable to help due to a lack of treatment pathways, as we've discussed. Long COVID Scotland have reported cases of long COVID patients being wrongly prescribed medical information interventions which exacerbate their conditions, such as graded exercise therapy. It was recently removed from the NICE guidelines for conditions that are reported to have similar symptoms to long COVID, but yet it is still being issued as a therapy to long COVID sufferers. Make no mistake, this is not the fault of healthcare profession or professionals. If the Scottish Government refuses to acknowledge long COVID or the serious debilitating nature of it as a condition, then how can healthcare professionals be expected to offer sufferers the care they deserve without the resources with which to do so? And long COVID patients are stuck in limbo where researching and advocating for themselves or their loved ones is their only lifeline, only source of hope in the face of this awful condition. Presiding Officer, I said earlier physical symptoms are legion, but they're only half the story because there's a range of other things that long COVID patients have to deal with. GPs and charities are doing their best, but the size of this phenomenon is on a different scale, and government web pages aren't much use to someone with air hunger who feels like they are suffocating and literally gasping for breath. Specialist COVID clinics should exist in every health board. There should be nurses peripatetically available, and there should be a dedicated care pathway. Many people who suffer from long COVID end up experiencing significant financial challenges as well, either because they're unable to work or they are having to shell out money for treatments and investigations. And when it comes to financial support, Presiding Officer, the benefit system has not yet responded to this debilitating condition. And when it does, there is a real concern that it will not be made available to everyone. There is a particular inequality, even among long COVID sufferers themselves. In March 2020, if you cast your mind back, our testing capacity was considerably limited to healthcare staff and a very small group of other key workers. Many of the first waivers, it's a term that they refer to themselves, were never diagnosed with COVID-19. It exists nowhere on their medical records, or as such, it makes it a definitive diagnosis all the harder. Many may never receive an official diagnosis or attendant sick leave or benefits that they may become entitled to. Most will be subjected to disbelief or accusations of malingering. Those with caring responsibilities are particularly high risk to this, and the threat of financial difficulties can end up pushing themselves beyond the limit and reducing their quality of life still further. People with long COVID are further discriminated against due to those lack of negative tests not having been hospitalised, and for pre-existing inequities such as socioeconomic status, race and gender. Presiding Officer, I understand I'm coming to the end of my time. There is so much more we need to say about this. We don't know how many of our citizens who caught COVID-19 in the first wave. We don't know how many are nursing it now and how many will contract it in the future. We are told that we may have to live around COVID-19 indefinitely. There is no vaccine for long COVID, and we still don't know how long it lasts, if it ever stops at all. This condition will occupy the attention and the business of this chamber for many years to come. It should not have taken an opposition debate in members' time to bring it to the fore for the first time, but I am proud to have done so this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I now call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Sandra Spilhany. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Alex Cole-Hamilton for bringing this important topic to the Scottish Parliament for debate. The numbers of people with long COVID are high, and this is a major public health matter. Over 75,000 people in Scotland today are estimated to be suffering from long COVID, and as the pandemic continues, numbers will only grow. One of my own constituents, Suzanne, who's suffering from long COVID, contacted me to help me understand the impact long COVID is having on her life. She told me, having contracted COVID in October 2020, I've been unable to return to a normal life. I struggle daily with fatigue and a number of other symptoms that vary on a day-to-day basis. I have gone from being a full-time working mum who studied part-time and went to the gym 3 times a week to somebody that I no longer recognise. I barely leave the house now as I need to prioritise what little energy I have to take care of my 2 young daughters. Now, while the physical health impact from long COVID has been severe in Suzanne, the story doesn't end there, and there are many like her. The life-changing impact of COVID also affects the mental health of both the sufferer and of their family too. For those unable to work, long COVID is causing financial distress too. Often for the first time in their lives, long COVID sufferers face the daunting prospect of navigating the cruel complexities of the UK social security system, a system unlikely to prove flexible enough to respond to their needs. So while there's still much that we don't know about long COVID, we do know that doing nothing is not an option, that we must act. And that's why I warmly welcome the Scottish Government's £10 million long COVID support fund for NHS boards. This fund is an excellent start to help NHS boards develop the flexible models of care that respond to patients' changing and varying symptoms. These flexible care responses are essential, and people suffering from long COVID make it clear there's a need for primary care to be strengthened, and the need to embed health and allied health staff locally to provide necessary supports, including rehabilitation services. It's also important that we ensure long COVID knowledge hubs have the latest up-to-date information so that those suffering from long COVID can better self-manage their changing and variable symptoms. Alongside frontline investment in services, research into long COVID is vital. The Scottish Government's funding of £2.5 million to support 9 research projects will be a rich source of data that can help improve services going forward. And it's this dual track of immediate strengthened service response and medium-term scientific research that will improve the long-term lives of so many Scots who are suffering from the life-changing effects of long COVID. And let's not forget our children and young people too, because while our young people are statistically less likely to suffer severe COVID symptoms, there can be long-term serious impacts on their health too. And on a personal level, I actually know 2 teenagers infected with COVID way back at the beginning of this pandemic. One now has immune system issues and the other has heart complications, and both are long-term. So I thank goodness that our young people are receiving vaccines in Scotland too. Before closing, Presiding Officer, I want to highlight the growing evidence that younger working-age women are more likely to suffer from long COVID, and we cannot allow long COVID to further embed gender inequalities. Today's debate, Presiding Officer, is an important opportunity to hear the voices of people with lived experience of long COVID, and I hope we hear more from other members. It's only by hearing their stories and listening to their asks that we can truly embark on improving their lives. We must listen now, and we must keep on listening.
Thank you. I now call Sandish Gulhani to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Up to 4 minutes, please, Dr. Gulhani.
I thank Alex Cole-Hamilton, my co-convener of the cross-party group for long COVID, along with Jackie Bailey, for bringing this debate. Presiding Officer, around 4% of Scotland's workforce suffers from long COVID. And for economists looking at the macro impact on the labour market or resourcing the delivery of healthcare services, long COVID is indeed a condition of concern. But this Tuesday evening, for many of our 100,000 Scots who are struggling with fatigue, dizziness, brain fog, pain in their joints, poor mental health, long COVID is much more than a concern. It's debilitating. Slurred speech, indescribable headaches, fluctuating heart rate, numbness, tummy issues. Thousands of people out there in our country tonight can barely function. According to the latest Office for National Statistics stats, over 90,000 people in Scotland have experienced long COVID for 4 weeks, 70,000 for 12 weeks, and 29,000 for 12 weeks. Months. Let's consider this. There's been a 16% increase in the number of long COVID patients since October's data was published. That's 16% in 1 month. We're not looking at just a condition of concern. This is now a crisis in the making. In my maiden speech on the 27th of May, I underscored the problem of long COVID from my experience as a GP. Then on the 1st of June, we debated the National Health Service Recovery Plan. I called on the Cabinet Secretary for Health to commit to establishing a specialist long COVID. So what are we actually doing here in the Scottish Parliament on long COVID? After meeting the Cabinet Secretary for Health and his advisers to discuss the creation of long COVID network based upon my suggestions, on the 9th of September, the Cabinet Secretary for Health announced £10 million long COVID support fund to help health boards respond to the condition. Then 3 weeks later, on the 30th of September, the Cabinet Secretary for Health provided more details, and the fund, and I quote, will support local services to develop and deliver the best models of care appropriate for their populations, which could include strengthening and improving the coordination of existing services or establishing dedicated services. Now, I'm pleased on the fact that government acted on my call and made the £10 million commitment. But that said, we really do need to step up a gear and sort out the details. Tackling long COVID is not simply a box-ticking exercise on a spreadsheet. As we sit here in Parliament, in our privileged positions, I can't help but think of 2 people who are suffering. A young mum who used to run 5 to 10 kilometres can now barely make it to the toilet and has moved in with her mum to look after her kids. and another a teenager of school age, a teenager, and she said this, "Mummy, how long is this going to last? I can't go on like this. I can't go on like this." To tackle long COVID, the government needs to urgently address some of the systemic bureaucratic barriers that are hindering the delivery of an integrated long COVID service. And I would urge the Minister in closing to try to get to the heart of that problem. Long COVID requires a multidisciplinary approach. The care pathway should reflect this, and patients should be provided with a personalised care plan. Presiding Officer, money has been allocated. There is a broad brush plan that leaves much of the decisions to the health boards. But in this Parliament, we are yet to see the details. We really need to know what the health boards are doing right now. What is happening this week, this month, next month? We need a timescale and a time plan. We need to know where our suffering constituents can go for specialist treatment. That isn't just England. The absence of long COVID action plan, that is the condition of real concern.
Thank you. And I now call Jackie Bailey, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating Alex Cole-Hamilton on securing this debate and for the content of his speech, and apologise for not being with all of you in the chamber. I'm delighted that the Parliament has formally recognised the establishment of the cross-party group on long COVID, and I am delighted to be speaking in this debate along with Alex Cole-Hamilton and Sandesh Gulhani, who are both my co-conveners. Everybody in the chamber will have somebody that is a constituent who is suffering from long COVID, because after all, there are almost 80,000 people affected, according to statistics from the ONS. But they are all ages, they come from all walks of life, and experiencing many, many different problems, whether it's chronic fatigue, brain fog, cardiac problems, or indeed breathing difficulties. And we heard very many extraordinary and sometimes harrowing accounts of how it affected people at the cross-party group. We heard from a mother whose young daughter is unrecognisable because she used to be energetic, she used to be cheerful before COVID. She has missed so much school, missed out so many friendships, she's not quite so outgoing anymore. And then the woman who'd spent a lifetime dedicated to the voluntary sector in paid work, currently unable to work and with an employer not willing to adapt to her condition. One of my constituents is in fact a nurse in the NHS. You would think that the NHS would understand, that they would be flexible, that they would want to retain her precious skills within the service. But she was feeling so harassed that she actually quit her job. Her skills have been lost to the NHS. And she is not alone. Many employers are behaving in this way. There are many more stories, people of different ages, different backgrounds, but I want to focus on what the Scottish Government is doing, because genuinely, I think the Scottish Government have been far too slow to act. At a time when there were specialist clinics and substantial sums of money going into the NHS in England so that people could be treated alongside research and defined clinical pathways existing in Wales, again, with money behind them, there was nothing available in Scotland. I had people going to their GP surgery, being consultants who then referred them back to the GP, a revolving door with little support at the end of it. But let me try and find consensus this evening, because the issue is far too important to do otherwise. The Cabinet Secretary has put £10 million on the table. That is extraordinarily welcome. But I don't think it's been distributed yet to health boards. I don't think there is a plan as to what will happen. And I share with my colleagues the frustration at the lack of detail, not just for us as politicians, but for long COVID sufferers and GPs trying to refer them into the system. There is undoubtedly a postcode lottery out there. So let me urge the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary to get a move on, to take action quickly, and to get the money into services where it's needed. And can I ask the Minister to convey to the Cabinet Secretary the urgency of him having a one-to-one direct meeting with Long COVID Scotland so that the views and life experience of those who actually suffer from the condition can help shape the proposals. Presiding Officer, before finishing, let me talk about the gendered nature of COVID very quickly, because we need to recognise long COVID, yes, as a disability, but also as an industrial injury. Women's exposure to the virus has been greater due to the gendered patterns of work. The majority of women, majority of frontline workers in health, social care and education have indeed been women. They have been the ones on the front line during this pandemic, more likely to catch COVID than anybody else. And HSE figures bear this out. For the 6 months, for a period from April to September 2020, 75% of COVID employer reports made in Scotland related to women. Women aged 50 to 60 are at greatest risk of long COVID. So for all those reasons, I hope people will support Mark Griffin's Members' Bill, which addresses many of these issues in relation to industrial injury. But it's time we got serious about long COVID. Please, I beg the Scottish Government to take action on services, to listen to those with lived experience, and please get a move on. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Beatrice Wishart. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and thank Alec Cole-Hamilton for securing it. As the COVID-19 pandemic continues, the need to understand and respond to long COVID is increasingly pressing. We've heard about the symptoms from other colleagues of persistent fatigue, breathlessness and depression, and that's been reported, and it can be particularly debilitating for many. There are many other side effects which are physical and psychological, and I will come to that as well. The term long COVID is commonly used to describe signs and symptoms that continue or develop after COVID-19. And most evidence about long COVID has been limited and based on small cohorts with short follow-up. I read research in The Lancet by Dr. Lixu Huang and colleagues that report 12-month outcomes from the largest cohort of hospitalised adult survivors of COVID-19 so far. At 1 year, COVID-19 survivors had more mobility problems, pain, discomfort and anxiety or depression than control participants. Fatigue or muscle weakness was the most frequent reported symptom at both 6 months and at 12 months, while almost half of patients reported having at least one symptom, such as sleep difficulties, palpitations, joint pain or chest pain at 12 months. The study shows that for many patients, full recovery from COVID-19 will take more than a year and raises important health issues for services and research. So I do agree that the motion that long COVID is indeed a condition of concern. I was particularly interested to hear about the impact of paediatric long COVID and the work of Dr. Benita Kane and Eliza Perego on this. And, Presiding Officer, the emerging scientific evidence shows that it's not an insignificant percentage of children, so it's significant, that develop long-term symptoms following exposure to the SARS-CoV-2 virus. I was going to go into more detail about some of the further information about paediatrics and research, but it's interesting that acute kidney disease, immune dysfunction, and some of the reported lung perfusion defects and ongoing inflammatory lung conditions up to 60 days into the post-viral infection. But I received an email this AM from a constituent who didn't want me to name the person because there's more than 1.1 million people suffering from long COVID. But basically, this person said that research to improve the understanding of the illness is thankfully now emerging, and this person thought it would be helpful to explain more so that I would approach the debate using the evidence base that is now emerging. He says that cardiopulmonary exercise testing has demonstrated that patients with long COVID suffer from impaired systemic oxygen extraction. Basically, it says it's not a psychological illness. Patients with long COVID cannot get oxygen from their blood to their cells, resulting in multi-organ oxygen starvation, explaining their widespread symptoms. And we also have seen that there are other summary of acute COVID-19 causes, which causes blood clots and micro-blood clots. And so we know that there is equipment in Scotland that can help deal with the laboratory tests and the thrombogenic coagulation disorders that seem to be appearing in our long COVID patients that are suffering. So, Presiding Officer, in summary, I would like to support what the Scottish Government is putting into place right now. And I know that we are still on the initial stages of research, but we need to make sure that we're taking action and we need to do it as soon as possible. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to my colleagues, Alex Cole-Hamilton, for bringing this debate to the Chamber. We've heard about fatigue, breathlessness, muscle aches, memory loss and persistent coughs alone, all things to be concerned about. But for some, these symptoms come all together or in a combination. For people in Shetland and many others across the country, long COVID symptoms have led them to radically change their way of life. In the summer, I urge sufferers to contact me and NHS Shetland in order to gain an understanding of local demand for long COVID support. It's only with an accurate understanding of how many people are still recuperating from COVID that we can get the care and assistance patients need. After my call, I received this from a constituent who asked that I add their name to the list of people who have had long COVID. They said, "Like many others in Shetland, I caught COVID last year just as they stopped testing and told us to stay at home and not bother the NHS. I did phone 111 during a very scary 48-hour period. A call back verbally diagnosed that my constituent had COVID and also a secondary infection of the lungs, and the doctor put them on a course of antibiotics. My constituent went on to say, 'Thankfully, I managed to get through it without having to go to hospital, but I so wish I had had the opportunity to get oxygen during the worst part. I believe I've been living with long COVID since overcoming the initial and secondary infections for well over a year now, and I'm currently battling a bout. I'm lucky in that respect. I only get bad bouts of it rather than suffer badly from it all the time. I feel like I've aged a decade in a year. My mind doesn't work at all well now, and I've less than half the energy I used to, but I can still function normally until a random bout hits me. And the various debilitating symptoms have me take to bed for 3 or 4 days. I've spoken a couple of times to a GP at the health centre and have been met with, 'But you haven't had a positive test result,' the point that others have made in this debate. And also not being believed. And Presiding Officer, this sounds to me very similar to management. Many ME and chronic fatigue syndrome suffered have experienced during many years. So I wonder if we have learned anything from that condition. In the summer, I was invited to hear directly from long COVID sufferers who had set up a support group in a church hall. I arrived, but no one else turned up, and it transpired that all the usual attendees were simply too poorly to come along. People who wouldn't think twice about going to work for 8 hours, or taking a walk, or indeed showing up to a meeting. Now, after having had COVID, they couldn't physically make the meeting as they were too unwell. In England, from December last year, 60 long COVID clinics have been available, but 1 year later, Scotland doesn't have any comparable clinics. Through written questions to the government, I understand that long COVID sufferers' support for assessment, diagnosis, care and rehabilitation should be in a setting that is close to their home. And that's an important point, especially for island, rural and remote communities. All that is being done is welcome, but as my colleagues Alex Cole-Hamilton has outlined, Scottish Liberal Democrats would go further with specialist long COVID clinics in every health board, the training of long COVID community nurses to offer in-home support, countrywide access to long COVID physiotherapy and multidisciplinary rehab, and
Member's just about to conclude.
A policy of no financial detriment for workers who are absent for long periods of time due to long COVID. In September, I called for a new built hospital fit for the 21st century to replace Shetland's current ageing building, a new build to support medical professionals deliver modernised NHS services with the equipment, space and provisions they need. Indeed, as the long-term impact of long COVID is not known, we may be relying on our hospitals and medical professionals in a different way as the pandemic continues to challenge our knowledge. COVID has had a large impact on so many of our lives. For some, every day is now a struggle after contracting COVID. We can't leave those people to suffer in silence. Thank you, Presiding
Thank you. And I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Willie Coffey. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to speak in this debate, and I want to echo colleagues in thanking Alex Cole-Hamilton for bringing such an important issue to the Chamber today. With an estimated 75,000 people in Scotland thought to be living with the lasting effects of COVID-19, and that number only rising, the urgency of recognising, talking about and establishing how we can support people with long COVID is great and becoming greater. The phrase, nothing about us without us, is a phrase that Long COVID Scotland have included in their briefing for MSPs ahead of this debate. It is a phrase that I and many in the disability movement will know well, and that is where I will start today. It means, in simple terms, that decisions about long COVID must be taken with people who have long COVID. As someone who spent years campaigning in the disability movement, I know firsthand how important it is to have a seat at the table. I also know through experience that until that happens, people with long COVID face an uphill battle to make sure that what needs to happen to protect their rights does. So today I make the case for and ask the government to directly and urgently engage with people with long COVID, especially Long COVID Scotland, and ensure they are involved in policy design, development and implementation every step of the way. This is a new condition, something we don't yet properly understand, and so it is not just good practice. In fact, it is imperative that people who are living with long COVID are front and centre of what we do to support them, because only they can tell us exactly how it's impacting on their lives. The Scottish Government must listen to their experiences and their solutions, and then respond with concrete actions that will address their health, social care and financial needs. In my time so far as an MSP, I've had the pleasure of meeting with hundreds of organisations across the third sector, and I've heard directly from them the impact this condition is having. Where the government haven't been there, the third sector organisations like charities like Ask Me UK, the British Lung Foundation and Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland have, as they always do, stepped up. They're already breaking their backs and their budgets to cope with the increased demand of the pandemic, and they were stretched to capacity before it, underfunded and under-resourced. Now they have to support people with long COVID added to the long list of the other things they do. They all say the same thing, that there are tens of thousands of people with the condition who continue to live unwell, unheard and unsupported, and that the Scottish Government is offering at best piecemeal support and not enough action to address their needs. So I'd like to first encourage the Government to support the third sector to do their work with people with long COVID, with adequate multi-year funding and support to recover from the last 20 months, and to place on record my thanks to them today, and in particular, Glasgow Disability Alliance in the region I represent, for what they do and what they have done in this year in particular. Deputy Presiding Officer, there can be no doubt that long COVID is having a huge impact. UK-wide research has found that 71% of people with it have said it affects their family life. 80% said it affected their ability to work, over half have had to reduce their hours, and more than one in five have been left unable to work at all. More than a third have said it's impacted their finances. These numbers show the desperate need to provide appropriate support to and do so quickly. But more than that, they show that this is a group of people who are experiencing socio-economic disadvantage and are disabled by most recognised definitions. To that end, I ask the government to recognise long COVID as an impairment for all equalities and rights purposes, workers' rights purposes and for social security. Not doing so will exacerbate the inequality that has already deep-rooted in our society, particularly among women. And my colleague Mark Griffin's bill to establish a Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council bill will allow us to do this. It would correct the process by which something is defined as an employment injury. It would lay the framework for a new independent statutory public body with authority to reshape and remodel the benefit, hopefully enabling COVID-19 to be recognised as an industrial disease. And recent figures have shown that 75% of employer COVID-19 disease reports made in Scotland were about women employees. Given 98% of workers earning poverty wages during the pandemic were women, this bill could create a safety net to prevent them from falling into poverty as a result of developing the long-lasting effects of COVID-19. Deputy Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I believe we must see long COVID as a disabling condition and recognise and realise the rights that people have. And we urgently have to have a national strategic plan to do this, developed in collaboration with those who have experience of it. The Scottish Government must act to do this now and to protect and promote the equality and human rights of everyone living with long COVID. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Willie Coffey, who will be our last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond to the debate. And Mr. Coffey is joining us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to Alec Cole-Hamilton for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And it's good to hear, I think, at least a few members welcoming the £10 million investment by the Scottish Government to help long COVID sufferers. When the pandemic stories from our constituents who didn't appear to be managing the virus, no one was sure on and why the symptoms persisted. We now know this to be long COVID, although I think it's still reasonable to say we don't yet know enough about it, even now, and why it persists with some and not with others. It's important to hear the voices of our constituents who are suffering from this, and I'm indebted to my constituent Eileen, who contacted me yesterday to ask me to highlight what has happened to her. Eileen is a frontline health visitor in Ayrshire with 36 years' experience, previously fit and healthy with no underlying health conditions. But if this persists, she might never be able to work again. She managed the initial stages of her illness at home, but experienced many symptoms that required visits to Crosshouse Hospital. After about 13 weeks of being very unwell, she was admitted to hospital having developed neurological symptoms and was an inpatient for 3 weeks. Paid for private neurology advice, which led to more investigations, but alas, no treatment. The best advice was drug management of some of the symptoms and to wait and see how it developed. Occupational therapy and some physiotherapy followed. Eileen continues to be supported at home by staff from the Douglas Grant Rehab Centre. Here are just a few of the impacts that she has to cope with at home. She has to sit in a stool in her kitchen to do simple food preparation and empty a dishwasher because she hasn't the energy to do it without this. Sometimes she can't even do that. She has to use a seat in her shower. Even going upstairs in her house is a major task, since it gives her heart palpitations and breathlessness. She can't even put her washing outside and has to use a walking stick in the house at all times, and she's bedbound more often than not. Eileen has gone from a relatively fit and healthy individual to a shadow of her former self and with no sign of it letting up. The crushing fatigue she experiences and the isolation at home is having a wider impact on her mental health now. Presiding Officer, sharing this story about Eileen, with Eileen's permission, of course, will resonate with many other members' accounts, and I'm sure with many other people watching the debate today too. At this moment, her future and that of many long COVID sufferers is at best uncertain. Her ability to do almost everything for herself has been replaced by an inability to do anything. A huge transformation in her health and quality of life. One of her messages to me said, "I feel like a pinball machine, with the COVID having hit every cell in my body at some point over the last 19 months. I'm single with a mortgage, and I'm so worried for my future." Presiding Officer, Eileen's story isn't unique, but it is heartbreaking and it's becoming urgent. My hope is that when the Minister sums up, we will hear some more about the research funding and ongoing support for long COVID sufferers, perhaps also about potential beneficial treatments we are reading about. For example, hyperbaric treatment appears to be having some positive impact. But hopefully, most of all, I hope we can hear that long COVID sufferers are very much in the minds of both governments to make sure they will continue to be supported in terms of their employment and financial obligations, and that the recovery from the physical and mental health trauma they are suffering will be a top priority as they continue to endure this incredibly debilitating condition. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Minister Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all the members who've taken part in discussing this important issue. Let me assure you that this government does recognise the negative impact that long COVID can have on the physical and mental well-being of those affected. And we're committed to making sure that people with long COVID receive the best possible care and support in a setting that is appropriate and as close to home as possible. A key point to note in our approach in Scotland. Our response to long COVID is built on a range of well-integrated support already being delivered across Scotland by our NHS, social care and third sector partners. Social support is available through local primary care teams, community-based rehabilitation services, and referral to secondary care for further investigation and advice where necessary, depending, and I stress, on what is right for the individual. Given the wide spectrum of needs that people affected with long COVID can have, we know that the full range of skills and knowledge of our multidisciplinary teams are required. And that's why we're investing £155 million through our Primary Care Improvement Fund to support the development of these teams. This includes, for example, the recruitment of further community nurses to assist with diagnostic tests and chronic disease management, physiotherapists to treat musculoskeletal issues in the community, as well as pharmacists to help with repeat prescriptions and medicine reviews. In our programme for government this year, we committed to publishing a paper setting out our approach to care and support for people with long COVID. And we delivered on this commitment on the 30th of September. Our paper sets out support that people with long COVID can expect and outlines 16 commitments to deliver a range of improvements. I'd like to... Certainly.
Alex Gohalton.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. She seems very confident in the offer that the Scottish Government are giving to sufferers of long COVID. And she has rightly outlined the document and strategy paper and the money and action points the Government have identified. But the long COVID community reported being devastated by that and felt that it was far too little, far too late. Is she telling this Parliament and the long COVID community that that is the full extent of the offer to long COVID sufferers, or is there more to come?
Minister.
No, I'm not saying that that's the full offer. What I will do, though, is set out some of the initiatives that we've already delivered on. I will look to other countries in the UK, and I will also, during the course of this speech, talk about some of the things that we're looking to deliver for those individuals who are experiencing long COVID. So some of the initiatives that we've already delivered on. Giving people access to clear information is a key part of supporting them to feel more in control of their condition. And last month we launched a new long COVID information platform and an NHS Inform specifically designed to help people with their recovery. We've invested £40,000 in public awareness campaign with information displayed in community pharmacies across Scotland about how people can access further advice and support in relation to their symptoms. We're supporting clinicians to access evidence-based information and advice on long COVID. We're actively supporting the application of the UK-wide clinical guideline and have worked with specialists to develop long COVID implementation support note. This gives clinicians across Scotland practical help around the appropriate assessments, investigations and referrals for their patients. We recognise the vital work of third sector organisations across the country in supporting people and communities, and that's why we've provided funding of £460,000 to Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland to enable them to deliver their long COVID support service. Through this service, people can speak to nurses who are trained in managing some of the most common long COVID symptoms, such as breathlessness and fatigue. The real-life experiences of people living with long COVID will continue to be a vitally important aspect of informing our approach. The Cabinet Secretary will meet this month with a whole range of organisations representing and supporting people with long COVID, which will be a really helpful part of informing our evolving understanding of the condition and of people's needs. Certainly.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for taking the intervention. Can you confirm if that will include the organisation Long COVID Scotland?
Minister?
Yes, my understanding is that it will. We have backed up the delivery of the commitments outlined in our approach paper with a £10 million Long COVID Support Fund, which will provide NHS boards with further resource to respond in a flexible and tailored manner to the needs of people with Long COVID, as well as appropriate training and education of staff. Recognising Scotland's unique geography and population distribution, the fund will support local services to develop and deliver the best models of care appropriate for local populations. Now, this could include strengthening and improving the coordination of existing services or establishing dedicated long COVID assessment clinics if a health board identifies this as an appropriate response to meet local needs. Mr. Cole Hamilton has made unhelpful comparisons to England, and it might be helpful for him to reflect on the reality of patients' experiences of accessing service there. Just last week, Francesca Steele wrote in the Times of her own experience of referral to an NHS England long COVID clinic. Her story is one of lengthy waiting lists, no follow-up, and ultimately, in her own words, the clinic was not the solution she'd hoped for. Indeed,
Dr. Gohani.
The clinic that I have been talking about since my maiden speech was actually the Hertfordshire model, and that is the best clinic I've heard of and the one that I would like to bring up here. It's got fantastic patient feedback and also has a GP and a dedicated team who look after the patients as they come back. So would that not be the model to talk about and best practice?
Minister.
So certainly we're willing to look around the UK, and obviously we're working on a four nations basis in terms of, well, we're certainly working with NICE and with Royal College of GPs and SINE working together in terms of developing clinical guidelines. So there's absolutely no reason why we wouldn't look at areas of best practice in England. But Ms Steele's experience is reflected in the findings of a survey, so her experience is not unique. It's reflected in the findings of a survey conducted by the group Long COVID Support, which found that only 26% of respondents were satisfied with their experience of NHS England's long COVID clinics, and 58% of those people were dissatisfied. Now, we don't want to make this a political fight. We want to concentrate on supporting people in Scotland in the best way possible for their needs. We've learned a lot about COVID-19 since the beginning of the pandemic. There's still a lot more we need to understand, particularly in relation to its long-term effects.
Do it very briefly, Minister, because you're running out of time. Emma Harper.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate you've taken many interventions, and I know that we have some diagnostic tests already that looks at fluorescence microscopes and thromboelastography, which is TEG, platelet mapping. So this work is currently available, and is that part of the government's work to take long COVID management forward?
Minister.
So I can assure the member that the clinical community in Scotland is looking at all of the evidence that's been produced. The clinical community actually across the UK worked together to produce guidance really very, very quickly in terms of responding to a new disease, and they're updating that guidance over I think it's the update is due very soon, so they are certainly looking at the evidence base. There's also funding for...
The Minister really should be bringing her remarks to a close, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. I think she has been fairly generous in interventions.
Okay.
Thank you.
So just to mention before I close, the government has committed to funding research, £2.5 million to 9 research projects, which covers a wide range of approaches and will address many of these questions that will greatly increase the clinical knowledge base on long COVID. In closing, Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity that this debate has given me to set out some of the actions that the government is taking to ensure that people with long COVID in Scotland can get the right support for them, support that's evidence-based, effective, safe and person-centred, an approach that is not one-size-fits-all, but one that provides support that is wrapped around the individual and enables them to access the right care in the right place at the right time. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.